thank you all so much for coming. I apologize for the obstructed view to some of you in this direction. I'll try to move around the stage a lot so you'll get at least some facial expression. I wrote the bio when I was accepted to present here while I still taught in Boston. I currently teach in Arizona, so slight difference. Although, as my mom said, I brought the warm weather with me, so you're welcome. I'm taking it with me when I leave on Monday, so I apologize. I loved working with musicians my whole life. I've sung since I was about 3 years old. There's videos of me babbling into a microphone and refusing to let my cousins steal it away. But I go back to those recordings from when I was in middle school, beginning of high school, even really the beginning of college. And I'm reminded of a moment when I called my friend Drew, who did undergrad with me, and said, "Drew, I found this video of me singing in high school." He said, "Dude, you didn't watch it, did you?" And I said, yeah, I did. And I think I should just quit singing and not be in college anymore. He's like, "Yeah, man, you never watch the old stuff. That's not." And my kids don't believe it. And you may feel the same way. You might be in your classroom and tell your kids, "No, don't worry. You know, I really struggled when I was young too." And they're like, "Yeah, sure." But luckily, those of us, those undergrads who are here today, will have video records through YouTube all the way back to their infancy to show their students that they were terrible when they were small children. I don't have those to share with you today, but hopefully I'll make a few vocal errors as we go today, and you'll see that I'm still struggling just like our students are and just like all of us are as well. Today, the goal is to convince you that when you think a child can't sing, you're wrong. As I've told many of my private students, I consider my job to be a crusher of dreams. That's why I make so many jokes and try to stay light and happy, because they come in and say, I love to sing, I want to sing, oh, this is so much fun. I say, well, my job is to tell you all the ways you're terrible and to try to fix them. And in any other job, if your job was to tell somebody all the ways their passion was terrible and that they were awful at it, you would say that you're a crusher of dreams. Anyway, so I've worked with a lot of students who had pitch matching issues, who were monotone, who couldn't match pitch. We're gonna break this session into several different sections. First part is, you think you can't match pitch, but it's some other issue instead. Technique issues, breath support issues, all that sort of stuff. Second part is, you think you can't match pitch and you actually are having trouble matching pitch. What are some strategies for addressing that in the classroom, in the choral setting, that sort of thing. Last session is, you have an individual who's really, really struggling. This is something that may not be as relevant for all of you classroom teachers. You might not always have the opportunity to pull an individual out and give them that remediation they need, but there are some extreme cases that are not gonna be solved any other way. And I can sugarcoat it and say that there are strategies that you can use so that every singer you ever run into will learn how to match pitch in a once a week, 40 minute classroom. It's just not true. There are some who need more than that. So we will spend some time in that last time. If you have private students, if you have that one really passionate kid who seems to sing so loud and so much stronger than everyone else, but you just can't quite get there. Or you have the child within your family who you care about but can't quite sing in tune, that you're willing to invest the individual time on, we'll do a little bit of work on that too. So, how many of you attended the Gordon Music Learning Theory workshop earlier yesterday? Great, so a few of you. So I'm not gonna go any depth into Gordon Music Learning Theory, but there's a quick concept I wanna give that I'll reference a bunch through the workshop. He talks about sequential vocabularies, which comes from language learning research, not just from music, but from English, any other language you learn, but that any one of these vocabularies is limited by the previous vocabulary. So if you look at your worksheet, you see the five listed out, the top is writing. You can only write what you can read. Makes logical sense. You can only read what you can think, you can only think what you can speak, you can only speak what you've heard. So the basic idea would be build the base of the pyramid very large, lots of listening vocabulary. From that, you start to repeat things that you've heard before, speaking vocabulary. You start to rearrange things that you've heard and echoed before into new patterns based off of old patterns in the thinking vocabulary. That's where improvisation, creation, all of that composition starts to come in. Reading is decoding visual symbols into oral symbols. Writing is decoding oral symbols into visual symbols. That doesn't have to be with notation. It doesn't have to be with ink. It can be on a board. It can be with hand signs. It can be with a hand staff. As long as it's oral to visual, it's writing. As long as it's visual to oral, it's reading. So the vocabulary goes in that sequence. One of the things I've found with pitch struggling singers is they often have a very small listening vocabulary. Many of them don't have parents who sing or produce music of any variety in the home. Many of them don't have music played in the home much at all. I was heartbroken recently when I started getting private students of elementary to middle school age who'd never heard of the classic Disney songs. So we come in that first lesson, I'd say, oh, well, let's sing, you know, your favorite Disney song, you know, Part of Your World, Can't Wait to Be King, you know, what's that? The Lion King. They're like, the what? You're breaking my heart. I mean, we used to, as an American culture, we used to have a musical heritage that we all sort of knew the same songs. As Kodai people, we've learned most of those songs that we used to know as a culture. And then for a while, it was really just the church that was doing that job of like, everybody would know the same sort of hymns, and you could use some certain hymn tunes. You could do Praise and Thanksgiving, Let Everyone Sing. You know, everybody kind of knew those general tunes. And then as people got more secular, most people didn't know the hymn tunes anymore, but you had these Americana songs, the flag songs, the national anthem, Oh Say Can You See, all these different ones. And that had that culture. You knew that any person on the street knew two or three flag songs. And then we lost it for a while. We had a lot of kids who didn't know any of those, a whole generation that knew no common songs. But we started to get the pop 40, you know, the top hits. Everyone knew some Beatles, everyone knew some whatever. Nowadays, online, internet, radio, and iPods in your ears, you don't have that common vocabulary. But we had Disney. Everyone knew Lion King, Little Mermaid, and Beauty and the Beast, and all of that. But now, we have this little gap.
Frozen.
Thank God for Frozen. As much as we hate Frozen, and as much as I don't necessarily want my six-year-olds modeling Idina Menzel for their vocal technique, I love her, don't get me wrong, but maybe not necessarily the best vocal model for elementary school, but they all know the song. There's a song that they all know, and when they come in, I can say, oh, you all know it? Okay, great. And one of the things I do is lead community sings. I get in front of a crowd like this, usually not musicians and educators, who believe they can't sing or have never really sung before, and get them all up and singing songs. But it's hard, because I'm trying to find that authentic folk music literature that a few of them have heard before to give them something to hang their boat on. I sing Amazing Grace, and half the audience has never heard it before. Blows my mind. So this listening vocabulary is very important. If you run into a student who you think can't match pitch, it might just be that no one's ever really sung to them. As I was sharing with a colleague last night, many young students have never heard a nice, well-produced, light head voice in their life. They come to us and they've just never heard it. And for male teachers, if we don't sing up in that falsetto, they've never heard it. And if they don't have somebody else in their class who's a stellar singer, they've never heard it. And they might get to middle school and have never heard a nice, light, well-produced head tone. How can we expect them to produce it if they haven't heard it? So build that listening vocabulary first. The other ones we'll kind of skip through, but just speaking is just echoing back what you've heard. So if I sing lulu, you've heard the pattern. If I sing lulu and want you to sing it back, lulu, that's speaking vocabulary. If I now sing lulu, now make up something, some weird combination of those two patterns. Stitch them together in some way. You can be creative. Add them however you would like to add them. Take those two patterns and arrange them in a creative way. Good, now you're using the thinking vocabulary. You're taking two things and putting them together in a new way you've never heard before, but it's all made up of elements you've heard before. And then reading vocabulary, everyone's familiar with hand signs, I assume. So, here, body eight first, please. And sing. Visual to oral, you're reading. And now I'm going to sing, you show me with your hands what I sing. Lulu, lulu. You're writing, visual to oral. Now, you can expand that more and more. You can use the board, you can use notation, you can make everything a lot more complicated, but that's the basics. You've now gone through all five. You can't start writing until you've done the reading. You can't start reading until you've done the thinking. You can't start thinking until you've done the speaking. You can't start speaking until you've done the listening. And if you find roadblocks with your students, it's often because you skipped a step. Oh, they're really having trouble reading that law. Oh wait, did I make them improvise with law? Did I make them echo with law? Did I make them hear law separate before they had to echo? Wherever you get stuck, go back a phase, practice it there until they're ready. So, common pitch damaging technique issues. Many people nodded their heads when I brought this up previously, but often when you think there's a pitch matching issue, it is not a pitch matching issue, it's not a hearing issue, it's not an audiation issue, it's that they have crappy reservoir, or they have a really tight neck and tight jaw and tight tongue. And so you go, ah, sing with me, and you don't have to say we'll have a group as an example, but ah, sing with me, and they go, ah, and you go, oh, you can't match pitch, you know, you're flat every time. Ah, oh, there it is, okay, fine. Yeah, teach them to breathe properly, teach them to relax here, teach them to align. I don't feel the need to spend 20 minutes on this extensively, but it's worth reminding that often when we first think, oh, this kid can't match pitch, I have a struggler, sometimes you need to look at the technique first. It they're not going to be able to be successful with their oral skills if they don't have the technique foundation to show what they know. So solid breath support, breathing from the diaphragm, relaxing the instrument up here, relaxing the jaw, freedom in the tongue, all of that's important. If you don't feel comfortable with that sort of technique teaching, then you should save some money, go and get a couple of voice lessons, and get comfortable in your own instrument if you're going to be teaching kids how to sing. It does, I'll get off the soapbox in a second, but it does frustrate me sometimes to see people who have their instrumental music education major and now spend the majority of their day teaching kids to sing who've never had a voice lesson. It feels a bit inauthentic to me. If I decided to go to an academy and I was spending the whole time teaching saxophone to kids and I never had a saxophone lesson, I was like saxophone before. It's nice, you can learn a lot of it on your own, that's fine. Watch some YouTube videos, get some online coaching. But find somebody in your area who knows how to sing, ask the high school teacher in your district, get a couple of lessons, learn how to use your breath support, learn how to relax your instrument, learn tall, in-tune vowels. A side note from the acoustical side of things, the reason different vowels sound different is because they have different overtones that are highlighted. So my ah, ah versus ah is a difference in overtones, not the fundamental pitch. But if this half of the choir sings ah, and this half of the choir sings together. Sounds out of tune, but it's not. It's the overtones that are starting to clash. And so you think, oh, my singers are singing out of tune. Sometimes it's a vowel issue. You can correct that. It's one of the reasons that it's hard to have to work too much on lining up the chords and developing pure intonation when you're singing on solfege, because the vowel will be different among the parts if they're in a chord. Mm-hmm. So if that is your intention, then maybe having to do it on blue or modify the vowels to get toward the same area, or just tell them that at the climax, at the cadence, to switch to an ah vowel. So you can check that intonation and switch them back to solfege. Because you will hear some wobbliness in the intonation just from the difference in vowels. All right, boys with changing voices often have trouble with registration, as we all know. Negotiating between head voice and chest voice. I mentioned before that if they haven't had a good model of head voice, you can go through elementary, middle, high school, get to college, and have never heard someone even speak in their head voice. There's this common thing now, with especially on females, where the voice kind of sits here in the back of the throat, and you got this vocal fry, and it's kind of back there. And especially among your middle school boys, I just found this. I left for Arizona twice in my life. First time I left, I had a young student named Ben, and he said, "Bye, Mr. Keene." And I came back a year later and picked up some lessons with Ben. He said, "Hey, Mr. Keene." I was like, "Oh, wow, Ben, that's amazing." And then I left for Arizona 3 months ago, and I came back this week, and I picked up lessons with all my students again. And I was so excited to see Ben. And I see Ben, he goes, "Hey, Mr. Keene." "Ben, what happened?" He's like, "What do you mean?" I'm like, "Ben, your voice is like an octave lower than it was when I left 2 months ago." He goes, "Oh, I don't know what you're talking about, Mr. Keene." So they're also forcing everything down there. If you don't model some of this up here every once in a while, and you're echoing, and you're speaking, and your instructions to the students, they've never heard it. And they're probably not hearing it in their classroom teachers, from their parents, from their peers. They might, but you can't count on it. So you need to provide that modeling in some way. If you are an adult male teacher, there are limitations there. It can be hard. We don't all have effortless access to our falsetto. I certainly didn't for the first couple of years of teaching. I'm lucky now, as my students say, I can hit an F, the top treble clef. I can't sing an F, but I can hit it. I can sing lightly in the upper area, but I couldn't for the first few years of teaching. So I would find that one bright student, as us male elementary teachers all know, you've got that kid who can match you at the octave perfectly on day one. Most kids can't. So you have that kid come up afterwards and they sing it. You teach the song to the choir, Billy sings it perfectly, obviously. "Oh, Billy, that sounds great, come up here. Billy, you sing it for them. Now sit class, sing after Billy. Billy, sing the first phrase. Now class, sing after Billy." If you do all of the modeling in your lower pitch, chest voice, even if you're in a light head tone, they're just not gonna be able to match the octave that well. It's a higher level skill. So once they have all those skills, if they're all matching perfectly at the octave guys, that's fine. If not, no. Question?
What? I have a scenario
Do you have any men you teach in your district who could come in and do
a day? My co-teacher is a male, but...
Does he sing it all in your...
Teaching at the same time, mm-hmm. So you can't
just run over my room. Sure. If there's any opportunity to get him into your classroom for 5 or 10 minutes, even if you can just have the two of you matching pitch on the same pitch, maybe middle C, middle D, somewhere in that area where you can sing the same note, he's in falsetto, headish voice, and you're in your regular voice, they can hear that there's a very strong similarity in the tone. Again, I think it's models more than anything else. You find the boy who can produce a nice tone, and you ask that boy to come up and sing, and then you ask the next singer to come up and sing next to them and match Billy's sound, and then Susie, can you come up and match Billy and Tommy's sound, and then you do that. They need to hear the quality models, and we are not always capable of producing it. Yeah. Again, like I said, in an ideal world, I'd like to say, I'd like to sugarcoat it and say we could all produce beautiful, child-appropriate models for everyone. It's not accurate. Some of us went to college as basso profundos and have this nice, rich, full. You can try to lighten up your tone, but you spent years of technique working on the big, rich, full tone. Some of us just aren't going to sound like kids. My best friend, Becca, who went to undergrad with me, who's here with me from Massachusetts, she has that beautiful, nice, light child tone, like effortlessly. And she's very jealous of those of us that have big, full, rich adult voices. But I said, I would trade your voice in a second when I'm teaching fifth graders. I would love to have a perfect, beautiful child tone. When you don't, ask a child who can produce it well to produce it. If you've got 20 kids and none of them's producing a decent sound, then you probably need to move back into the curriculum a little bit and start with some foundational technique work. So registration is the other big thing. Breath work is often an issue. Tension is often an issue. Otherwise, it's registration. They're having trouble negotiating head voice versus chest voice. You find this in middle school a lot. You may have had the boy who can match pitch perfectly in fifth grade, comes into sixth grade, all of a sudden he's all over the place. He didn't forget how to match pitch. He didn't lose that. He just has a new instrument. He went to sleep with a violin and he woke up with a cello. And I mean, it's similar, but he needs to learn how to stretch his fingers a little bit more. You'll see this in middle school and high school especially. You see the guys who, like, their arms and legs grew faster than their brains learned how to use them. And the same thing's happening in here. They don't know how to use it yet. They need some time, they need to adjust to it. And often, as I said, unfortunately, they need a male model. They do. I mean, if they're going through a voice-changing voice, they need to hear what an adult male sounds like, what an adult male sounds like in falsetto. I'm not saying you can't provide that, but maybe you need to ask your male colleague to come in for 5 minutes and just say, this is what my man voice sounds like. But I can also sing up here, and it sounds a little bit different than when the females sing up here. There's a slight difference in the quality of the tone. My falsetto's a little bit airier than the girls' voices are, but it's still part of my man's voice. And you can ask the high school men's a cappella choir or the local college men's group to come in, and when they hear those high tenors sailing up, and they see the girls around them swooning and clapping. The boys be like, oh, I think I can sing falsetto. You show a video of Michael Jackson, of Bieber, of the Jonas Brothers, of Justin Timberlake, they'll be on board. They'll be fine. So they do need modern. Do you have another question? Follow up?
Yes. So is the expectation, is even if they are going through voice change, that they can still match my pitch? Or are you putting
that is entirely dependent on their current range. And so that's one of the things I have a lot of private students who are boys going through the voice change, and I'll tell them, my guess is educated, but it's not necessarily highly accurate. A lot of it's guesswork. I said, I can tell you where I think your range is gonna be in 2 months, but it's like a 30% chance that it's right. My favorite comedian is Dimitri Martin, and on his recent special, he said, how bad does a guess have to be for it to be an uneducated guess? So like what's the weather out like today? And carrots? Dude, it is not now, nor has it ever been carrots. That is an uneducated guess. So I can give an educated guess about where someone's range is gonna go, but you can't really predict from day to day. I would not have guessed that Ben, when I left, came back 2 months later, that his voice would have dropped down to here. He gained a fifth in those 2 months. And it had been a year since he had gained a second in his lower range. He's 15, I mean, he's in the middle of the time for all that to happen. But 2 months, 5 notes. 1 year, 2 notes. You can't predict it. So I'll take the questions in 1 second, but I do want to say the last technical issue is that maybe you're asking them to sing outside of their current range. And I have some boys, they got into high school, they had no singing, they didn't sing through middle school, they didn't have that proper training, they came to me as a ninth grader, had this boy, everything is down here, everything's a complete monotone. And he couldn't really match pitch at all, and I worked with him, we got some pitch matching down here, he could and he could get that, and I could finally get him to do and that was it. And I would move up the scale, brum, brum. It's just those are his 3 notes, that's all he's got. And if he's only got those 3 notes and you ask him to sing a different note, he doesn't have that note, so it's gonna sound out of tune. But maybe he can be in tune in that little, 3 notes down here on the bottom of the staff, his or A, B, and C sharp, he can sing there, he can't sing out of it. I have some boys who can sing, right in the middle of the staff, they've got maybe a fifth from the F to the middle C. I've got some boys that can still do the falsetto, no problem, they're speaking down here, they can match pitch up here, but there's a big gap where their voice disappears there. You just gotta go with the singers you got. I mean, you can't magically give them more notes. You keep singing through the gap, you do lip trills and sirens and stuff to connect the head voice to the chest voice, and you hope that it fills in. But for some of them, it takes 2 or 3 years. And for some of them, it takes 2 or 3 days. and I can predict it with maybe 15% accuracy. So if you work for years and study it and work with a ton of students, you might get to 15% accuracy. That's as far as I've seen anyone get. I've never met someone who could guess with 50% accuracy where a voice changing voice would go. So they do need to hear that falsetto, the head voice, and the man's chest voice and learn the difference between the two. When they first start those registration changes, there's gonna be a big gear shift. Like the first day you learn how to drive stick. Most of you are undergrads in 2015, so stick is this old way that cars used to be drive, or you didn't get to do the gear voice. So sometimes you go to shift and ka-chunk, you get that little, you know, you feel the gear shifting. Boys in the changing voices, they'll have that for a second or 2 seconds in the beginning. They'll go, and eventually they'll get a little bit smaller, and they'll go, and eventually it gets a little bit smaller, you get, and eventually you get, as you teach them the mix in the middle, but the gap gets smaller and smaller. Eventually it's so small you don't really notice it, and soon enough you smooth it over. But you just gotta accept that it's there, and they need that permission from you. They need to hear you say, it's okay, that's what boys' voices sound like. These times, I feel like I can do it better as an adult male, I can say my voice sounded that way. But many of you females also had a significant voice change through middle school and high school. It may not have been to the level of the voice cracks, but you had some breathiness coming into your tone, what they call the whisper triangle, and the vocal pedagogy, that little part of the vocal folds that stays open through adolescence. So all those teenage girls have the sound, and sometimes that's just physiological. Sometimes they are at the level where they can coordinate full closure, but sometimes it's just, you know, for a couple of years you're gonna sound breathy, because that's, your vocal cords have grown and your strength to close them has not grown, and you'll develop it over time. I saw a couple questions before, I wanna grab them before I move right on. Yes?
I just have two things, because I'm new to middle school and mm-hmm. now maybe in my third year. One is that when I have these boys, first of all, they're all changing a little bit differently, ask a little bit different times. I have like 7 boys, and and it's hard for me to know
how to adjust, because next week it might be different.
I'm in a choral arrangement, and,
yep.
you know,
and then 2 weeks later they can't sing it.
Yeah. Yeah. So anyway, I mean, I think that's just, you just gotta go with it.
Yeah, and you've gotta be honest with it. Yeah, you gotta be honest with yourself and say, you know what, sometimes I'm gonna spend time writing a desk scan for them in 3 notes, and then next week their 3 notes are 3 different notes. And you just maybe
sometimes I actually say, you know, you can't sing these 3 notes, so
yep.
just fake it for these 3 notes.
Sure, so and at a certain point you have to, depending on your instructional time, one of the soapbox issues I have is kids who can't match pitch and can't keep a steady beat but know what Tchaikovsky's birthday is. If I had 5 hours a day to teach every student music, sure, I'd teach Tchaikovsky's birthday. But when I have 1 hour once a week and I have kids that can't match pitch, you gotta bet, I don't care what Tchaikovsky's birthday was, the kid can't match pitch. It'd be like having math teachers that can't add. It'd be like having English students in senior year that can't read. There's fundamental skills, and these other things don't matter. We teach music class, we don't teach musicians class. We teach music class, we don't teach about music class. If they don't have the fundamental musical skills, there's a big problem. And I'm not saying that there's an issue with the teaching. I think there might be an issue with the teacher training. There might be an issue with the fact of what we got when we were in elementary school ourselves, and that comes back and we have that modeling there. There's 100 issues. So I'm not trying to blame teachers. However, the statement I would make is that if you met a math teacher and you met a math teacher who's responsible for K-12, or you had the math teachers from a whole district, and you had several seniors who couldn't add after 8 or 9 years of math instruction, start to question the curriculum, the teacher training, some issue is there. If we have students that can't match pitch and keep a steady beat after 8 years of general music instruction, there's an issue somewhere. There is. So I'm gonna move on for a second. I'll take more questions a little bit later, but I wanna get into some of the actual strategies. Assuming you've done the technique work, you've done the listening vocabulary stuff, you've assessed this student actually does have pitch matching issues. It's not some other, it's not registration, it's not that they haven't heard a good model, they legitimately just can't match pitch. There are a few things. This, as we know in Kodai land, ample use of echoing, meowing sounds, barking sounds, mooing sounds. This is my big grumbly voice. This is my little baby voice. You know, that kind of stuff really helps. It's fun. They laugh. They sail around. As I was talking to my colleague at lunch, and she said, you know, my kids always complain that it's too high. It's too high. It's too high. I go to a D on the staff and go, it's too high. It's too high. I go, take that kid to a Justin Bieber concert, listen to her scream, and ask her if it's too high. She has the range, she doesn't have the motivation, she doesn't have the skills to access it. She can get up there. We can, sighs, sirens, moos, meowing, all that sort of stuff can get you there. I assume you're all doing that, so I don't want to spend too much time. But if you're not, lots of echoing. Individual singing every single day, even if it's just for attendance. Hello, boys and girls.
Hello, Mr. Keene.
Good. Hello, I don't see any of your name tags. Hello, Nancy. Good, and so then you can quickly, you know, you're banging out your attendance anyway, you get all of their voices really quickly once a day, you change up the patterns throughout the year to make them a little bit more complicated, you simplify the pattern for the kid who you know is struggling, you move your range down for the kid who's stuck down here and only has those three notes, you adjust, but you need to hear every kid sing every day, because then, when that one kid needs a little bit of intervention, a little bit of special attention to bring up their skills, you're not singling them out and making them feel weird. Every kid sings alone every single day. So you say, oh, hey, Billy, we're gonna sing for, you know, maybe 30 seconds today instead of 15 seconds. We're gonna sing for a minute or two and fix some stuff. You know, oh, class, listen to what's happening here. Is Billy matching my pitch or is it different? Okay, Billy, can you move your pitch up? Can you move it down? It's a lot safer if you've been singing individually every single day for 5 months than it is if you sing as a group every single day and then one day at the end of the year, all of a sudden, hey, Billy, you're on the spot. Goodbye. Yeah. And again, you'd never have a math teacher who said, I give group tests to all my students every single year. Everybody takes the math test in a big group and they're all fine. And I don't worry, I know. You would not be surprised that teacher has some kids who can't add. It's easy enough to not have to add if the whole class is doing it together. They only ever sing together. It's not surprising that some can't add. So individual singing every day, getting the struggling singer when you have issues with them to produce the pitch first. That is a fundamental skill in Kodaly land and in Gordon land. We talk about sequencing. The lower level of the sequence is produce your own pitch. The higher level of the sequence is hear a pitch and replicate that pitch. So if they can't do the second level of the sequence, take them back to the first level of the sequence. Can you make a note? Okay, fine. Now, I'm gonna match your note. Okay, there we are. Do you feel what that feels like? That's a different set of skills than me producing a note and asking you to replicate it. Never singling out individual students in front of their peers unless they volunteer. Now, this goes against a little bit, you know, what I said about individual singing every day. I just mean in the context of a class where you don't do this already. If everyone is singing individually, then it's not singling out to spend a little bit more time on one student. But if only one student is responsible for singing alone and no one else ever has to do that, it's a rough social situation that you're setting yourself up for, and you'll probably get tears and maybe a letter home from mom, which none of us like to deal with. Making sure they know what singing in tune feels like. This is so powerful for me. I had this lovely student, Becky, sweetest girl I'll ever have. I took over a failing school district in Massachusetts, 7 kids in choir on my first day. One of the top academic school districts in the state, but 7 kids in choir, ready to be cut. Got it up to 14 in the first year, got it up to 35 in the second year. One of the only students I had all 4 of those semesters was Becky. And Becky is the girl who loves to sing, so passionate, really huge voice, can't carry a tune in a bucket. And this was my first 2 years of teaching. I hadn't had a lot of this experience that I'd done. I hadn't done the research. I just like, wow, why can't this girl, you know, can I put stronger singers next to her? You know, all the stuff we learned, you know, try to, but her voice was so powerful. It was just always sticking out. And I go back to those recordings, I still hear it. I started private lessons with Becky, which is where I was really lucky to work with her. Again, you know, I don't want to sugarcoat it. I don't think I could have helped her if I didn't have private instruction. Some people are like that. She was probably the only one I've had in choir that was like that. But you might have that kid that just can't help them in choir. You need an hour once a week for a couple weeks. For her, it took a year and a half. But I finally one day was sitting there and I got the message of, oh, I need to start from her pitch, not from mine, because she can't find my pitch. And she would go, oh, you know, stuck in her chest voice or whatever, and match her, and she'd run away from me. We're playing follow the leader, but not intentional. I finally catch her, and she can't go any lower, and I've got her. I'm like, okay, stay right there. Yeah, I got you. I said, okay, what does that feel like? Can you sing, ah? That warmth and openness. I wouldn't necessarily say wobbliness. They confuse that with the beats that you get with out-of-tune singing, but there's an openness that you feel when you sing. And we as singers know what in-tune singing feels like, but you have to find words that feel authentic to your singer to describe that feeling. You have to label the feeling so they know what it is when they find it. And when I finally clicked for her, she's like, oh, you mean that like big, warm, like that open, wobbly thing? I said, yeah. She goes, doesn't that mean you're singing the wrong note? That was the 4th semester I had her in choir when I found out that the feeling of being in tune was what she thought meant when people, because people would tell her, she knew she sang flat. You know, somebody would rip her in the arm, you know, I talked to her about pitches, she was, you know, I can't stop every student from talking to each other in the hallways. People say, no, you were struggling with the flat, like, I'll tap you when you're out of tune and I'll help you. She just associated that feeling being out of tune because she couldn't hear herself. She lost her voice in the crowd. And again, the better you match your vowels, the more in tune you are, the less you can hear your voice. And she assumed, I can't hear myself, I must be doing something wrong. So first strategy is get loud. So, I assume that you all will be able to hear yourself when we sing in tune. Chris, I'm gonna ask you, assume you can't hear yourself as we all sing, try to get louder until you can hear yourself. Everybody? Ah. Anybody have that kidding choir? That's what's happening. They can't hear themselves. So the first strategy is get louder. Now assume the louder doesn't work. What else could you do? You can change the vowel. So you start fixing vowel shapes, but they're always gonna go back because they can't hear themselves. What's the last thing you could do? Now he can hear himself. There it is. So it might not be a pitch matching issue. It might be a I can't hear myself issue. There's a product I love, which I didn't get to bring with me because I was flying from Arizona and it looks really weird and I didn't want security to stop me as I was going through. The tuning forks are weird enough. They're like, what are you gonna do with that, sir? Get off my back, buddy. But they're called hearphones. It's mentioned in there. It's F-O-N-E-S,
yeah.
Hearphones. They're little plastic things that go around the side here, cup your ears. If you put your hands like this in front of your face and sing, ah, nice light throat tone. You can hear yourself a little bit better, right? This is why we see the pop singers doing this, all this kind of the girls doing that, all that sort of thing, whatever you know, I don't know what you're gonna do. You do something. But these do it for you. They look kind of weird if only one kid's wearing them, you know, they feel singled out. But if you make everybody wear them, you get 3 or 4 pairs, and you say, okay, one person in each section wear them, and then every 5 minutes you say, okay, switch off, give it to your neighbor, so everyone has to wear them. And you say, oh, Becky, will you wear the earphones for most of the beginning of rehearsal today? And that's what happened. I had all the kids, and some kids would say, Mr. King, can I wear them today? And they would put them on. But some kids, I would just say, hey, on this song, put this on, because, I want you to really hear how your vowel sounds compared to everyone else. Because they're singing in tune, so they're kind of getting lost in the sound, but the vowel isn't like it. So those help a lot, or teaching them the strategies of putting up your hands like that, help yourself hear yourself. But just, again, as with the boys, with the cracks, give them permission. Say, it's okay, you're going to not be able to hear yourself in choir sometimes. That's a good thing. I think we all, especially the young people around here, would say that we've had our parents come up to us after a concert, or friends who are not musical, and say, you did such a good job, I could hear you the whole time. Thanks, Mom. It's not the point. Appreciate it. But some of the kids, the kids, that's what they're hearing. Their mom is coming up after and saying, good job, honey, I can hear you the whole time. Or dad's coming up and saying, hey, honey, you need to sing louder, I couldn't hear you. If they're getting that at home 5 times, and they get once a week from you, singing a blended tone, what are they gonna listen to? So that's that. Flip over to the second page if you've got the worksheets. You don't need them because I'm going to read them out to you. But again, rearranging parts, add ostinatos, get friends who compose or arrange. Ask me to help you out writing a desk hand. I'm happy to help. But find somebody who can arrange your music. Figure out what your kids' notes are. If they only have a few notes, adjust your music for them. They need you to do it. If they don't have those notes, they can't sing them. And they're going to sound bad, or they're going to mouth the words in the concert. And if you ask them to mouth the words in the concert, they might mouth the words for the rest of their lives. Mm-hmm. And that's what I've spent my life to. Consider arranging your own. I have a colleague, Jennifer McCormick, in Arizona. She's happy to connect with anyone over Facebook and is very brilliant with all this stuff. And she gave me this large paragraph that I'm not going to read out loud to you. But we will do the exercise. So if you set yourself on your lap, sit up, singer's posture. As my old teacher used to say, stand up from the waist up. Yeah. And it always confuses the kids. They'll say stand up and they'll immediately say it from the waist up. They go, oh, okay. But it's fine. So sit up nice and tall. You can't lip drill, it's a tension issue. This is a way to fix that technique issue. If you smile, put a smile on your face, try to lip drill. It doesn't come out so well. Especially those of us who are trained instrumentalists, you have a thing called embouchure, which is the opposite of what you need when you sing. So if you have a kid who's in band and in choir, they might think music class is the class where I purse my lips and keep them tight. And they go, and they can't get a nice, healthy, warm tone. So relax everything. Nice. We're going to do a stagger breathing exercise, so just try to hold your note as long as you can. As you start to run out, take another breath. Don't let everything collapse like an accordion. Keep it nice and open. If you add me on Facebook, I just posted this video I saw the other day of this woman wearing an all-black bodysuit with a skeleton outline on it. It was so cool. I don't know if you've seen it. Yeah, some of you might have seen it. She collapses her posture, and you see the black space disappears from her sides or in her costals and everything. The ribs get closer to the pelvis. And she tries to breathe, she opens up. All of a sudden, double the space, double the breath. Amazing visual for my students. I showed it to one of them, they're like, oh, I get it now. I need to stand like this because that's where all my air goes. Now, your air doesn't actually go there, but that helps you get your air. So it's a bridge to get from there. So add me on Facebook, I'll show you the video. But keep everything elevated, breath from here. Don't let this collapse as you run out of air. Just keep it going. I would like three volunteers. Three volunteers. You, you, and you. As we're singing, go out of tune. Just hold the note a little bit lower, a little bit higher, go out of tune, I'll come to you. Okay? Sing lightly so you can hear what I'm saying and what I'm doing as we go. Boys, can you be in the higher octave, please? In unison, thank you. Good. Three singers, go out of tune. Have the one kid out of every 2 or 3 years that needs the individual attention to get to the level where they can match pitch. I'm not going to sugarcoat it. Some can't be done in half an hour once a week in a 30-person class while you're carting around from school to school and trying to get a power bar in between classes. It's just not practical. But most students, this will help. So that's her exercise, which she really likes. You know, don't bring any attention to anybody, don't stick anybody out. And she shared that with me on Facebook. I was like, oh, that's brilliant. Can I steal it and put it in my workshop? She's like, yeah. And that's a good chance to say 99% of what's in here is not mine. I don't remember whose it was. Some of it might be Mary's. Some of it might be some of yours. I don't know. But thank you to anyone who gave me stuff that I now take credit for. So, yeah. That's why I don't put a copyright on it. That last page, as it says, the individual instruction sequence. Many of you will never be able to do this with your students. You just don't have the time or the capacity. I don't judge. As I said, there are some students who will not improve without the individual attention. This is the sequence I would take them through. Chris, could I get you to come up here and help me out a little bit?
Yeah.
Awesome, man. Give a little round of applause for a volunteer. You can take your chair. So first, can they identify high and low? So I'm gonna assume for now, do everything right until I tell you to do it wrong.
Okay.
So can they identify high and low? Chris, tell me, am I high or low?
Here's my note.
You're low.
Here's my note.
You're high.
Here's my note.
You're low.
Okay, I have not met someone who didn't do that. Now, if you've met that person who could not tell, you've met a truly tone-deaf person. Congratulations. I will give you $100 if you can get them on a Skype call with me so I can see it in real life. I've never met them. Because if you're truly tone-deaf, you can't hear between high and low, you wouldn't know that this is a statement and this is a question. Because the only difference is tone. It's the only difference. You wouldn't know. You'd ask them a question and they'd think that you're just talking to them. You call them on the phone, they wouldn't know if you're a boy or a girl because they can't tell the difference in the tone. I've not met that person. They may exist. I'm not saying they don't, barring severe physical mental disability. If you're born without a neck, if you're born without ear holes, sure, maybe. I don't know. I've seen weird things, but I haven't met them, and I would love to meet them. I will honestly pay you $100 if you know that person. Can they identify large pitch motion? Am I moving up or down?
Up.
Up.
Down.
Good. Can they identify small pitch motion?
Small.
Yeah, is it up? Is it up?
Down.
So, can they identify pitch consistency? Am I going up, down, or staying the same?
Up.
Same. Some singers just can't identify consistency. Those of you who are in solfege right now, I know many of you are just finishing and are so grateful to have finished your solfege journey. Solfege is my favorite thing in the world, so I'm not envious of you. And sincerely, Millersville people, congratulations. You are awesome. I'm having severe undergrad envy right now with how awesome your program is. I really wish I could have come here. I almost want to get a second bachelor's degree just to come back here. It's fantastic. I'm so inspired by all of you, so thank you very much. But, I'm sorry, I almost went into you. As you all know, hardest part of sight reading is not notes that move up. It's not notes that move down. It's when you run into the same note twice. Yeah. Which you think is the easiest part. Just don't move your note. But every time I mess it up, and every time my kids mess it up, and every time most of your kids probably mess it up, pitch consistency is a thing that needs to be taught as well. Is this the same note as well? Most of us just teach up and down. We never hit that. So he can identify all of those things. If he had a trouble with one of those, if he couldn't identify when it was the same, I'd go back a level and say, okay, let's work on that small pitch motion. Okay, this is what it sounds like when I'm on the same note. Okay, can you hear that? Okay, let's show it on the piano. Okay, let's show it on a trumpet. Let's show it on a recorder. Let's show it in many different contexts. Work through there. So we keep working through here until we hit a roadblock. We find a skill they can't achieve. We move back a step and work them back through. most students can do most of these things with by the time they're in first, second, third grade, but if the struggler is struggling somewhere, as I said, the first two or three levels, like, I've never met a kid that can't tell, I mean, they just don't know the words at that point. Like, it's just a vocabulary issue, more than an identification issue. But if you meet them, tell me, you'll get $100. Producing pitches. Can they produce a variety of sounds, high and low? Can you make me a high sound, Chris? Can you make me a low sound? Can you make me a sound in the middle somewhere? Good, that's great. He can do it. Can you make large pitch motion? Can you do a motion from the bottom to the top of your range? Good. Can you do it from the top to the bottom? Good. Can you slide all the way through those? Good. Can you slide smallly? Good. Good. And that's the foundational skill to correct his pitch. When you hear that he's singing the wrong pitch, he has to be able to slide. If he can't make those sliding motions, that's something that needs some more time. You gotta spend some time with him, show him some models. If you're a different gender than the student, you might need to get somebody else to model for them. Bring in another student during recess who you know can do it, get them to play a game, make it into an imitation thing. There are lots of different options. Once you've got them producing all of those things, can you produce pitch consistently? I wouldn't, I skipped steps because I'm asking to match my pitch, but can you just sing a note and not let it move up and down? Good, very good job, Chris. So, can you tell when I'm doing those things? It's the same. Okay, did my note move? Good. Identify matching. Can they notice when I'm matching their pitch? Chris, can you sing the pitch? Am I singing the same note or a different note? Same, yes, which can be thumbs up, thumbs down if I'm doing the same. So sing a different note. Great, so we can identify that I'm matching. This is the moment where you might need to teach them what that feeling is of the warm, open, wobbliness, whatever they need to call it. You should ask for their words. You can give them some options of hear the words I feel when I hear this, but use their words, because your words might mean something different to them. I found with my mom that when I was in high school, some of you might have had this experience, if I asked, why did you lie to me? Why are you such a liar? She would flip off the handle, be very angry, scream at me, you know, send me to my room without dinner. But if I said, why didn't you tell me the truth? She was fine with that. The word liar had a lot of baggage. But I said, you know, why weren't you honest with me? That was fine. But the second the word lie came out, and it didn't mean that. I was a mom. That means the same thing. Why do you care? But to her, it meant something different. To them, wobbly might mean something different. To them, warm, open might mean something different. Ask them, when I get this feeling that we're the same, that we have the thumbs up, what does that feel like to you? And make a note of what their word is. And when they're off in class, say, hey, go for that fuzzy feeling. It might be fuzzy, but it might be sparkly. It might be, it feels like rainbow unicorns jumping over my forehead. Okay, Billy, go for the rainbow unicorns jumping over your forehead. Oh yeah, Mr. Keene, sorry, I forgot. They were jumping on my shoulders. Yeah, good job. Great. Can the singer identify if you're high or low or the same pitch? Can you tell me if I'm high, if I'm low, we're on the same? Mm-hmm. Okay, sing your note. Good. Can you guide me to my note? Or can you identify when I go out of tune with you and then show, we already showed this, can you guide me back to your note? So can you, by this, give me direction instead of just identifying?
Yep.
So sing your note. Cool. Now I know he can do it. Now that he can do it for me, I can try doing it for him. That is easier. Mm-hmm. That what he did is easier than me trying to do it for him. If you skip steps, just like I said with the Gordon language literacy, try to jump to writing before they've done it in reading, before they've done it in thinking, before they've done it in speaking, there's a problem. Some students can skip steps. I was that math kid that they say, show your work, and I just show a picture of the stick figure with the clouds over it and say, and just put the number, like, I just thought, like, that's all, you know, 2 + 2 = 4, show your work. I'm like, it's 4, that's, I know, I don't need to, you know, you divide the quadratic formulas and everything, I'm like, yeah, I just know what the factors are, I don't need to break it down, and that's fine, you might have those students, but some students are not those students, and that's not what we're talking about today. I'm sorry, I pointed to you when I talked about students, but some students cannot do it, they need the attention. Chris is brilliant. Very good job, Chris. Can you follow my directions to move your pitch up and down? So sing a pitch. Good. He can follow. Now I can start interacting with my pitch as well. Can he follow me when my pitch moves up from there? So now we're playing follow the leader, but I'm controlling it. So sing a note. Good. So he's following my pitch. Now I can correct him with this as well. Matching, when I sing a pitch, can you follow my directions to reach it? Sing a lower note than me. I sing a pitch, can the singer close their eyes and match it with careful listening? Close your eyes, listen carefully, don't sing immediately, audiate. He moved a little faster than I would let my students do. I'd say I asked you to audiate, I don't think you gave yourself enough time to audiate. Although he's a very fast audiator, so that's fine. Can the singer match your song pitch immediately in the traditional way we mean match pitch? He can match pitch, we're done. That's close, it's over. A kid who can do that is no longer tone deaf, can't match pitch, you know, whatever you want to call them, drone or monotone. I was going to say metronome. Hope it gets a metronome. That'd be really useful. I had an ear training teacher who claimed to have perfect tempo as the equivalent of perfect pitch, that like you could just say, you know, 68 beats per minute, she could just, I didn't have perfect tempo, I didn't have metronome, and I couldn't check her. So I don't know, maybe she did. If you meet one of those people, I won't pay you $100, but I'd love to meet them. So please tell me. And then I have a few more things above that that are just a higher level of literacy. Can they match to a piano, which is a different level of skill? We think kids can't match pitch. Sometimes they just can't match at the octave because I'm a male voice singer and they're up there, or because they're a male voice singer and you're a female singer and they're trying to match down the octave. That's why I magically, after being in districts in 7th and 8th grade as an alto, couldn't match pitch as a 9th grade baritone. My teacher was female, she would sing me my notes, I couldn't match, didn't let me in the advanced choir because I couldn't match pitch. Although I was at the high level district festivals a year before, I just couldn't match the octave. I never had to do that before. I always heard my notes in my own octave. Same thing with the piano. Some students can match there. This is actually very interesting. Some students, this is true with perfect pitch as well. There are people who have perfect pitch for their instrument exclusively. I knew a trumpet player who had perfect pitch on trumpet. He plays something on the piano, no idea. You sing him a note, no idea. And he would be out of tune when he sang, but perfect pitch for the trumpet because he played the trumpet his whole life and never sung. So it's a different set of skills that you need to build. If they can't match the piano, they maybe can match the voice, but it's harder. Can they match patterns? That's where we start to get into broader stuff. You can, of course, expand it into scales, modes, chords, all the big fluffy stuff as well. But ask these questions when you're working with an individual singer. Try to go through this. Thank you so much to Chris. Yeah, round of applause. Chris is fabulous. And I'd like to share, Chris, do you mind if I share a little bit about the anecdote you told me last night?
No.
Okay, great. Right. So me and Chris were talking a little bit last night, and he shared that he had a lot of mismatching issues when he was younger, and I did too. And I'd like to say, if you ever struggled with this, sincerely, be grateful. I know a lot of teachers who never struggled with certain singing concepts, who never struggled with literacy, who never struggled with pitch matching, who struggle now to teach anyone who does. And they say, I remember my first ear training lesson in fixed do, conservatory trained teacher sat down and said, sing me a major third. Here's your starting note. Sing me a major third. I said, I don't know what that is. Sing me a major third. You're a musician, you're a music major, you got into college. Sing me a major third. Don't know how to do that. She couldn't conceive of someone who was accepted to college for music who didn't know how to sing a major third. It's a foundational skill. We hopefully will live in that world someday. We do not right now. We probably won't in the next 1,000 or 2,000 years. don't assume that your students can do what you can do. And if you had poor experiences when you were younger, be grateful for them. They're so wonderful. They give us that opportunity to help our kids, to see, to guide them through those low levels of instruction. And those of you who are undergrads or just graduated right now, be grateful that you live in a time where you can pull out those recordings from your mom, from your elementary choir concert, and from your middle school musical, and from your high school auditions, and you can say, hey, this is what I sounded like. You already sound better than I did when I was 2 years older than you. Trust me, we can get there. Don't worry, kid, you got this. I wanna share one or two stories before we go. I did a community sing event in Arizona at a church. And I shared that in the research of Dr. Brené Brown, if you haven't heard of her, please Google her. I'll include some links in the email that I sent out afterwards. She researches vulnerability and shame. And her research around students and adults who've gone through educational experiences found that up to 85% of people, when polled, said they had a traumatic experience that forever changed how they saw themselves as a learner. A single experience they could remember as an adult. When polled, they said, half of them said it was around creativity and artistic expression. They had a single experience that forever changed the way they felt as a learner. I say to you as music educators, as stewards of our profession, as guides and parents in lieu of the parents to our children when they're with us, that one small statement can have a very profound impact on a student. You have to be careful with what you say. And I make a lot of jokes, and I say things I shouldn't, and I've made mistakes in front of students before, and I've apologized and tried to be honest with them. But I'll always remember after this community sing where I shared the research, I had a 94-year-old woman come up to me afterwards and say, you know, this was the first time I've actually sung in probably 80 years. I haven't sung since I've been a kid. And I was like, I'm so grateful. Thank you for singing with us, for trusting us for doing this. You know, she'd been at the church for years and had never sung the hymns with them. But I gave permission to the group that everybody should be singing, and people are moving their mouth, like, oh, where are you? Oh, can't hear you. Come on, let's go. They had permission. And she came up to me afterwards and said, you mentioned that specific moment. I can still remember fifth grade, backstage about to go on in the little red dress, and Miss Smith, whatever, I won't say her name, Miss Smith said, honey, just melt the words. Nobody wants to hear you. Mm-hmm. She couldn't remember the color of the dress 80 years later. It was that powerful. And she decided in that moment, never sing it again. Not taking that risk. Could be a parent, could be a sibling, could be you. Could be the child themselves. They might hear themselves back on a recording, try to make a YouTube video, and 27 people online make the kind of comments that people make on YouTube. Just the child who sings. We have those moments, and we have the responsibility, if not always the power, to tell them that it's not true. And we make jokes, and we say, like, oh, this person's tone deaf, oh, that guy can't sing. The kids hear that. And they say, oh, there are people who can't sing. Maybe I'm one of those. Mm-hmm. And sometimes I don't sing the right. You know, we watch American Idol, we watch The X Factor, and they say, well, that guy's terrible. Is that what's gonna happen to me if I try to sing in front of people? I see students every day give up on singing. Middle school boys, it's a minefield, it's a minefield. And then they can never come back. You know, they can. As I was saying to my friend Rebecca earlier today, I wish that I could help every adult that believes they can't sing. I wish I could help them know, but I truly believe they can. But when we talk about statistics and populations, you can't isolate an individual from a statistical truth. I would say probably 90% of the people who are adults and believe they can't sing will never sing again. But does that mean when I meet an individual who says they can't sing, that individual can't learn? No, not at all. They each deserve that chance. But I think I can make a bigger impact with kids, with college kids, and especially with teachers and future teachers who are going out there and are going to say to the students, you can sing. Everybody sings. The opening chapter of my book, I talk about the difference between I can't sing, I won't sing, and I don't sing. Mm-hmm. People don't use the right words. They say that kid's tone deaf. Like, okay, can they hear when you're asking them a question? They're not tone deaf. Can they tell the difference between low and high? They're not tone deaf. Stop using the word. Kid hears it, they think they might be it. So, Brené Brown is the name of the researcher, BrenneBrown. I'm running up on my time. I'm gonna share one more story at the end rather than taking questions because I'd only get one or two in. If you have questions, please come up to me afterwards and ask them. I'm happy to share them. I'll stay right here and I'll include some extra information and all the email stuff as well. But I do just want to share before I go. This girl, her name was Gabby, and she was the sweetest kid. Her name was very appropriate to her. And she was the kid who would come up to me after choir rehearsal, and she'd come up and go, Mr. Keene, Mr. Keene, Mr. Keene, do you know Brandon? I'm like, yeah, you mean Brandon who sits next to you in choir? Yeah, I'm aware of him, yeah. We've met. Yeah, what do you think about him? Like, do you think he's cool? Yeah, seems like a pretty cool dude. Seems pretty chill. So, oh, okay, I'm like, do you like Brandon? She's like, well, maybe he asked me out. Okay, yeah, cool, really awesome. She was the kid who'd be talking during every rehearsal. She would mouth the words. She wouldn't sing out that much. She never really produced a lot. Now, I had a fifth grade choir once a week for 90 minutes, pulled from five different students. I did not have time to do what I need to do with that student to give her the enrichment she needs. If I had that individual time to pull out, maybe. But I wasn't teaching in any of those schools. I had no other time to see her. I couldn't take away from rehearsal time when I only had once a week. So she probably still couldn't match pitch that well by the time I got to the end. I don't know for sure. I didn't hear a lot of individual singing in that choir. We were pushed to festival. There were a lot of other factors. I say this to let you know that when you feel like there's extenuating circumstances, there are. Forgive yourself. It's okay. It's okay. But when you have the chance, take advantage and try to touch the life. And what I've seen, we went to festival. We got a gold medal. The platinum was the highest. But I told them, if I get a gold medal, we're going to Six Flags after, and I'll go on a roller coaster with you. Hadn't been on a roller coaster in 10 years. Still had nightmares about them every month, even though I hadn't been on one for 10 years. That's how much I don't like roller coasters. But I told them I'd go, and they got the gold medal, and I, you know, played out the field. Oh, I can't believe it. And they loved it. And I went on the roller oral question. I had so much fun that I immediately wanted a second one. So it was a blast. I had a really good time. And we get back at the end of the night. It's 11 o'clock. We're offloading the buses. We're getting rid of all the equipment. We're loading up the band stuff from the band. And I'm saying goodbye to kids. And it's the last time I'm going to see them. There's only one grade in this course. I don't teach in the school district. They're going to go on to something else. I didn't know I was moving to Arizona at the time, but come to find out, I'm not even in the same part of the country with them anymore. Students come in and go, thank you so much, Mr. Keene. Parents go, thank you so much. I really appreciate it. And I see Gabby kind of, you know, dragging her foot, like, you know, looking over at me and kind of trying, and then see somebody else come and just put her eyes down. And she comes up to me finally and says, Mr. Keene, bye. And she holds me and hugs me. 2, 3, 4 seconds. Okay, you got it. And she pulls back and just turns away and looks back and goes, bye. And in that moment, I know what she was really saying was, thank you, I love you, I appreciate the impact you had in my life. She didn't have the words to say it. She didn't have the emotional maturity and strength to say it at that age. But I have said it to them every single day, and I will say it every day, and I don't care what the administration, the parents, the national media says. I will tell my students I love them every single day. Some students only hear that from one adult per day, and it's their music teacher. And they don't hear it at all. And they don't hear it from their friends. And I feel that that's part of our job. And if you don't love your students, I don't know why you're still here, because the pay and the respect are not that great. I've always said, when people say, oh, you seem to work so well with kids, if you love kids, working with kids is the best job in the world. If you hate kids, objectively, it's the worst job in the world. It's terrible. So you don't love them while you're here. Love them, love yourself, forgive yourself, talk to me, send me an email. Anything I can do to help you, I love you. Thank you for being here.